Well, now we're going to move into our third session, our final session. Hey, that's to make you smile. We're going to be looking at what is the Spirit given to us by way of gifts, and what is His desire in this regard. You're okay? Do you want it?
Yes.
You have a question?
I can ask a question.
And no. before we look at these gifts of the Spirit, I'd like to just briefly explore something that Paul says in Ephesians, because he says that he wants us to be filled with the Spirit. Do you want to have a little look at this verse? I know it's very familiar to you as Christians. It's in chapter 5. He's got a couple of imperatives that he mentions in chapter 4 and chapter 5 and chapter 6. So in chapter 4, for example, he says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Do not make him sad. I don't know if you know this, but when he makes this statement, he uses a term for the Holy Spirit that is unique in the New Testament. He says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. It's a very full title. And the reason he does it is because he's actually quoting from the Old Testament, and he's referring to a time when the Old Testament prophet speaks of a time in the Jewish history when the Jewish people did grieve the Holy Spirit of God. And the response of God, who was grieved, was to destroy them in the wilderness. That's what the Old Testament text says. Paul, who quotes from that Old Testament text, says to the Christians in Ephesus, don't be like those folks. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God as they did. What he doesn't do is add the extra piece of information that's in the Old Testament, which says the punishment that the people received from God who had been grieved by their activities. Paul, have you forgotten what the Old Testament text says? No. Paul doesn't include it because the Spirit deals with us differently to the way that the Spirit dealt with the children of God in the Old Testament. The Spirit does not destroy us when we grieve Him, but He still feels the pain. He still feels the hurt. He still feels the disappointment. And Paul's message to the Christians in Ephesus is, don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God, not because if you do, you'll be punished, but don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God who has sealed you. In other words, you are hurting your friend. You are hurting somebody who has guaranteed you. You are hurting somebody who has said, I am looking after these people. You are disappointing him who has committed himself to you. That makes the act of sin so much more serious when we realize we're hurting our best friend. Now, elsewhere in Ephesians, he has other imperatives. And in chapter 5, he says, be filled with the Holy Spirit. This is in verse 18. It's very familiar to you, but the reason I mention it is because of what we're going to be looking at later. If I was to ask you the question, please don't answer, if I was to ask you the question, are you filled with the Spirit? I suspect that some of you might say, yes, I am. In fact, I did this in a conference of Pentecostal leaders last year, about 100, 150. I said, how many of you are filled with the Spirit? Because they were Pentecostal leaders, they all put their hand up. And then I said, that's very interesting because I'm not. They were rather shocked by that because most of them knew me and thought, oh, dear me, he's not a Pentecostal after all. The reason I said what I said was because I think that I am using this term in the way that Paul meant. You can agree to disagree with me if you wish, that's fine. So let's have a little look at it. Paul says, be filled with the Holy Spirit. He's speaking to Christians. Now he doesn't say, be full of the Holy Spirit. He says, be filled. He doesn't say be full of the Holy Spirit as a once-in-a-lifetime experience. He says be filled. In fact, as you probably know, he's using this perfect tense again, which is to be translated be being filled. It is a continuous activity. The truth is, you will never be completely filled with the Spirit, but you must continually and continuously be allowing the Spirit to fill your life, my life. Now, we have a problem because of the verb fill. It sounds as if the Spirit is a liquid. I have been in settings where I have been encouraged to drink him in. Open up your mouth. Drink. I've been in settings where you've been encouraged to breathe him in. Can you smell him? Breathe him in. Now, I understand the mindset of the people who are asking the question. They want us to recognize the close proximity of the Spirit to us. But the trouble is, they are leading us into thinking that the Spirit is some kind of non-person. He's a liquid. You can drink him in. You can breathe him in. We used to sing a song, which I quite like, which went like this. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. You know the song? It's a good song. I haven't got a problem with it. But I remember a time when I thought, that's what you do. Fill me, Spirit, fill me. If I open my mouth big enough, more of you can come in. Because I was also told that at the end of a day, when you've been with non-Christians, the Spirit will have leaked out. I don't quite know how he leaked out, but there wasn't as much of him in me as there was at the beginning of the day when I had my morning devotions. But little by little, he was just leaking out of me like perspiration. And by the end of the day, there was hardly anything of him in me, just in my toes. That's all that was left. And all of this creates the image that he is some kind of non-person. And that couldn't be further from the truth. Paul's presentation of the Spirit, he is a member of the Godhead. He's not just a person, he's God. He's certainly not a liquid or a material. But we are led in that direction by the term filled, be filled with him. So I have to ask the question, Paul, do you realize that you're in danger of not helping us by this verb? In fact, Paul says, don't be filled with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. Paul, you've done it again. You've made me think that the Spirit is a liquid. Don't be filled with the best Bordeaux. Be filled with the Spirit. Now, maybe Paul knows that the church at Ephesus has a problem with drink. They're always getting drunk. And so maybe he's saying, now listen, the one problem you've got is you're always drinking. Don't do that. Be filled with the Spirit. Maybe. But there is no evidence that the Christians in Ephesus had a problem with getting drunk. No evidence at all. So why else are you using this comparison, this contrast? Well, let's think about how else this term fill is used. Luke speaks about a man who came to Jesus who was a leper. But Luke says this man was full of leprosy. In other words, he didn't just have a mild skin complaint. He just didn't have a form of leprosy that was not fully blown. He was full of leprosy. In other words, leprosy defined him. He was completely a leper. You may remember Simon the leper. He was called Simon the leper after the leprosy had stopped. It still defined him. That's what this verb is intended to do. Remember Elymas? Luke mentions Elymas in the book of Acts. He was a man who was full of deceit and villainy. That's what defined him. That's what controlled him. Deceitfulness. Ah, now I understand why you're using this verb here, Paul. You were trying to tell me I need to be filled with the Spirit, i.e. defined by the Spirit, controlled by the Spirit. He could have used those terms, it would have helped me, but he uses another term and compares it with being drunk. But now I understand why he's using that comparison, because when somebody gets drunk, They are not controlling their agenda. The drink is controlling their agenda. They are now doing things because they are drunk that they would never have dreamed they could have done until they got drunk. And maybe they don't even remember what they've done once they've got sober because the drink was setting their agenda. Paul says, now that's an image that you're used to because a few years ago that's what you were doing very regularly, getting drunk. And you know that you weren't in control, the drink was in control. I want somebody else to be in control. Who's that, Paul? It's the Spirit. Ah, right, I understand. So when you and I talk about being filled with the Spirit, let's be careful what we're saying. Because if I say I'm filled with the Spirit, what, according to Paul, I am saying is I am controlled by the Spirit. And if the Spirit is not controlling me, I need to use a different definition to describe myself. Here's where I'm coming to the bridge between what we're going to be doing in a couple of minutes. Sometimes people use the term, especially if they're Pentecostals, to refer to Christians who have a charismatic gift. Oh, that person is Spirit-filled. He does miracles. Or that lady, she's definitely Spirit-filled because her prayers of healing are so successful. Or that man, yes, he's Spirit-filled because his ministry of exorcism is powerful. And we can be sometimes misled into thinking that being filled with the Spirit is either a definition of somebody who's been baptized with the Spirit or somebody who has some noticeable charismatic giftings. Paul tells us what a person is like if they are filled with the Spirit, because he says in verse 19, the very next verse, I want you to be filled with the Spirit, I want you to be controlled by the Spirit. Well, how do I know that, Paul? How do I know when I'm manifesting the Spirit? How do I know when the Spirit is controlling my life? Verse 19, well, I'll tell you, you'll be addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. You'll be singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. There'll be an element of praise in your experience. Oh, so no charismatic miracles necessary to demonstrate that the Spirit is controlling me. No, you just start enjoying the fact that God is your God and Jesus is your Savior. Anything else that will manifest this? Yes, verse 20. When you start giving thanks for everything. Oh, blow me down. I didn't anticipate that. There's a lot in my life I don't want to give thanks for. Well, if you know that the Spirit is controlling your agenda, you will increasingly recognize that nothing that happens to you happens by accident. God's in charge, so you have the right to thank God for everything in the name of Jesus. Anything else, Paul, that will manifest that I am being controlled by the Spirit? Yeah, start submitting to one another. Oh, I don't fancy that, because there's quite a few people in this congregation that you wouldn't want to be submitted to if you were here, Jesus. So why are you asking me to be submitted to them? Well, if you are submitting to them, putting your agenda second when it's appropriate so to do, then you will be manifesting the Spirit's control in your life. And he continues in chapter 6. He says, wives, submit to your husbands. That is a demonstration of the Spirit controlling your life. Thank you, Judy. Start submitting to me. It's the only time I've been able to say it in 41 years, and now I can say it. You need to submit to me because that is proof that you are. There you go. Oh, hold on. That's not the verse I'm looking for. Look at that. Paul says, you husbands, start loving your wives. Why? Well, here's the one reason. That should be fairly obvious, shouldn't it? But here's another reason. Paul says you should be loving your wives because that's the way that you will demonstrate to your wife, to anybody else, to any supernatural being looking, that you are obeying the agenda of the Spirit. Whoa. So when I say I love you, or when I do something for Judy to demonstrate my affection for me, I'm not doing something just for me to do that, but it's a way of obeying the Spirit's agenda for our lives. It's a sign that I am being controlled by the Spirit. Children, obey your parents. Fathers, don't discipline your sons and daughters in an uncaring way. These are all practical ways of demonstrating that we are being controlled by the Spirit. Very interesting. Paul doesn't mention once that a manifestation of you being filled with the Spirit or you being controlled by the Spirit is that you will have a surfeit of spiritual gifts. He doesn't mention that. He says, here's the way to prove that the Spirit is controlling you. Are you in good relationship with one another? Are you enjoying being together? Are you demonstrating care and sensitivity for one another? Are you loving one another? Are you being practical in your relationships with one another? Because if you are, you are not just doing good to each other, but you are making the Spirit happy. You are demonstrating that you are being controlled by Him. Funnily enough, do you remember when, right at the beginning of this session, I spoke about disappointing the Spirit? How do you disappoint the Spirit? Well, surely if you murder people, that's going to disappoint him. Or if you kill the pastor, that's not going to make him very happy. Yep. Pastor Jennifer's just pointing in the direction of Pastor Rene for that one.
She's not controlled by the Spirit.
Where is he? So we tend to have a hierarchy of sins, and the big ones are going to disappoint the Spirit. Paul, funnily enough, says, let me give you an idea as to what's going to disappoint the Spirit. He says it in the verses following. It's when you're nasty to one another. Oh, dear me. I didn't expect that one, Paul, because I am nasty to people from time to time. Well, if you are, you're disappointing me. But if you are careful to love people and you're sensitive to the needs of people, that's a means of demonstrating that you love me. So it's quite interesting that Paul's presentation of disappointing the Spirit and being controlled by the Spirit have to do with our relationships, one with the other in the church. Interesting. So that is not to say that the Spirit does not manifest himself in our lives through spiritual gifts. He does. But don't think that that's the only way that he does it. So now let's talk about spiritual gifts. Let me take you back to South Wales, which is where I come from, which is a country, about 2 million people, just tucked away on the left of England, I was going to say rather more important than England, but there are English people present, so there would be quite inappropriate for me to say that. Some who are also called by my name, Keith, but I'm not going to mention who they are. It's a land of mountains and sheep and rain. So if you like any of those, or all of them, then you must come to Wales. You'll enjoy it, or not. I was brought up in a Pentecostal church. We believed in spiritual gifts. We actually believed that there were 9 spiritual gifts. I have subsequently learned that there are rather more spiritual gifts, but in those days we were told there were 9. I had a problem with that as a young Christian. The problem was I didn't have any of them. And more to the point, it didn't look as if anybody else in my congregation had any of them. My pastor, he was the one who gave the speaking in tongues that was to be interpreted. So that was one of the 9 gone. We had a lady in the church, and she was the one who always interpreted the tongues. That's 2 of the 9 gone, 7 left. You can see where this is going. One of our elders, whose name is Jack, he's not long ago gone to be with the Lord. He was the one who gave prophecies. That's 3 gifts gone, 6 left. Now, I knew that in the 9, there were gifts of healings and gifts of miracles, but we didn't see too many of them. So that's 5 gone, 4 left. Point is, it didn't look as if there were any gifts left to go around the rest of the congregation. In that group of 9, there are the gifts of wisdom and the gift of knowledge. But to be honest, none of us really knew what they were or what was the difference between them. So we couldn't tell whether anybody had one, if they did or not. So that was 7 gone. And it appeared to me that I was the only one who was asking the question, where's the gifts that we're all supposed to have? And in my youth, I assumed that once a year, when you clearly went to God and asked for a gift, he would look around in the bottom of his big barrel of gifts and give you a gift, if he had one. But many years went by when I waited for a gift to be given to me out of this big barrel of gifts. Nothing came. And I lived in relative happiness because nobody else had a gift either. Now, I fear that there are many Christians who think the same. And they think not just is the Spirit somebody who turns up once in a blue moon and does something good, but also they think that if he is going to give a gift, he's obviously going to give it to somebody other than me, whoever you happen to be. When the truth is quite different. So I would like us to explore a passage of Scripture together and see what Paul has to say about gifts of the Spirit. If I lapse into calling them spiritual gifts, please stop me, because I'm trying to train myself to use the term gifts of the Spirit. I do that because sometimes the term spiritual gifts implies that they are given to spiritual people. And you achieve a certain level of spirituality, and then the Spirit says, you've just cracked it. Excellent. I'm going to give you a gift. Now, of course, if you achieve a higher level of spirituality, you'll get a better gift. And when you reach nearly perfection, then you'll get the gift of miracles or something like that. They are spiritual gifts because they're given by the Spirit. That's why they're spiritual gifts. Now, of course, that's not to say that the Spirit wouldn't prefer to give his gifts to people that he can rely on. And if I'm not walking closely with God, and if I'm not allowing the agenda of the Spirit to manifest itself in my life, then I shouldn't expect him to give me the honor of functioning with him in a spiritual gift. But if I am doing my best, and let's remind ourselves, God does not expect us to be perfect. He expects us to be different. He expects us to do our best. And if we're moving in that direction, then we can expect that he will want to take advantage of us to work with him in achieving his will. Not because he needs us. We've been here. He doesn't need us. He can do it so much better on his own. But he says, come on, let's both of us work together to achieve this. So we're talking about gifts of the Spirit that he gives to the church. So we're going to look at a passage of scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. It's coming up on screen because I've chosen these particular verses. Now, you may recognize them because prior to verse 4, Paul begins a description of the spiritual gifts. And he carries it on right through to chapter 12 and also in chapter 14. Now, it appears the only reason that Paul talks about gifts of the Spirit, I just said spiritual gifts, didn't I? And you were too gracious to point me out, but I reminded myself that I did make a mistake. Paul seems to talk about gifts of the Spirit simply because the Corinthians are getting confused about them. That's why he talks about it. He's responding to their questions. So we don't have a systematic theological description of gifts of the Spirit. We have his response to their questions, and we don't even know their questions. We've only got his response in 1 Corinthians 12. But sufficient to say that in his response are embedded some very important aspects relating to the gifts of the Spirit as they relate to Christians. That's what these verses do. From verses 8 and 9 and 10, you have the list of 9 gifts that you may be familiar with. I've left them out because I'm not interested at the moment to talk about individual gifts of the Spirit. I'm interested in talking about the principles. My question to you is this, and you can talk amongst yourselves, especially if you're next to spiritual people. So I'm sorry about that, Brigitte, because Pastor Rene is next to you. Or you can just do it on your own. But I'm looking for key aspects of gifts of the Spirit as they are located in these verses. Don't answer me yet, but have a little think. And if you've got a piece of paper, or you can use your mobiles or whatever you have available, I'm looking for some attributes of gifts of the Spirit that we can think about as they're on these verses. I'm going to give you about 3 minutes to do that. If you found more than 23, you found 18 more than me. So we're looking for just a handful of properties relating to gifts of the Spirit. Do you understand my question? So what does Paul tell me about gifts of the Spirit? What are the principles that are involved in this description? Okay. Don't answer yet. I'll come back to you in a few moments. Another minute. I'm just getting a bit concerned because I can see Pastor Rene's got about 18 so far. And he's still writing. Okay. Pentecostals don't do silence very well. Somebody's going to start a chorus soon, so I'm... Somebody, tell me something about the gifts of the Spirit as they're reflected in these verses. Give me that again. Gifts of service. Interesting. Yes, you're right. They are described of gifts of service. You may remember that Paul refers to gifts of the Spirit in the book of Romans. And there his emphasis in chapter 12 is on the fact that if you say you have got a gift from the Spirit, then use it. Gift of prophecy, then prophesy. Gift of giving, then giving. And the emphasis is on using the gifts because it looks as if the Christians in Rome were tempted to be saying, well, of course, I've got the gift of wisdom. And somebody else says, well, I've got the gift of tongues, thank you very much. And somebody else says, well, I've got this gift. And Paul says, well, if you've got a gift of the Spirit, use it. Don't glory in the fact that you have a gift. Use it. Be practical in its application. And if you can't be practical in its application, you might want to question whether you have that gift at all. They are intended to benefit other people. That's your point. The gift of the Spirit, if it devalues somebody, it's probably not, well, not probably not, is definitely not an authentic use of the gift. Okay, good. It is intended to benefit somebody else. Okay, some more points, some more aspects of the gifts of the Spirit. Once you've given one correct answer, you are not allowed to play. Right, okay, so again, it's actually, that's somewhat similar. There has to be some manifestation. Some authentic manifestation. Good. Some more?
Empower.
Oh, they are. There is a powerful element to them. We're going to come back to that, actually. Who? Interesting. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit. In other words, actually, let me just... This is 1 Corinthians. Let me just get the text up here in the original. That's going to help me a little bit. The Greek word here is energeo, which is where we get our word energy from. The Spirit energizes them. The Spirit initiates them. Significance of that is, if the Spirit is in charge of them being given, should we pray for a gift of the Spirit? I think that from time to time it is appropriate to pray for a gift of the Spirit. Now, Paul doesn't address this particular question, and there are many questions that I have of gifts of the Spirit that are not addressed in the New Testament, because the New Testament isn't addressing my questions, it's addressing the questions of the Christians in the first century. So sometimes when we're answering some questions, we have to put our Christian experience into the context to be able to decide the answer. So I come back to my question, if the Spirit is in charge of giving the gifts, he's the one who energizes them, he's the one who empowers them, what are you trying to tell me, Paul? I think what Paul is trying to tell us has got a number of strands. Number one, he's saying, don't be frightened by the gifts. At the beginning of this chapter, in chapters 12, 1 to 3, he says, now, concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I want you to know this. Some of you, when you were heathens, when you were pagans, when you were part of the Corinthian lifestyle, which didn't have Jesus in it, the spirits led you all over the place. Generally bad places, but sometimes you thought that you were being led in the right direction and it ended up in a life addiction or some controlling habit that wasn't good for you. This Spirit, he's different. Remember what I said earlier? If you were with me, I said he's called the Holy Spirit because the word holy means different. It doesn't mean he's sinless, although he is. It doesn't mean he's perfect, although he is. The word holy, hagios, means he's different. He's different to any other kind of spirit. Different in what way? Well, he can be trusted. He's safe. He's on your side. He wants to do you good. He's reliable. So Paul says to the Christians, previously the Spirit's led you all over the place and it was often bad. This Spirit is different. This Spirit, for example, he says in verse 3, will not inspire you to say Jesus be cursed. Don't worry about the Spirit making you say things and you think, oh dear, I should never have said that. He'll never do it. If the Spirit's going to inspire you to do anything, it's going to be to say Jesus is Lord, because the Spirit and Jesus work together. So he's to be trusted. So I think he's saying the same here. The spiritual gifts that you have are all empowered by the same Spirit. And what have you learned about the same Spirit? He's on my side. He does my good. He works with Jesus. He works with the Father. He's reliable. He's true. He's authentic. There's integrity related to him. Fine. Secondly, I think he's saying, so allow the Spirit to take charge of what gifts he wishes to give to you. He's more interested in you functioning as somebody whom he has gifted than having you keep pleading for a specific gift. Oh Lord, please give me the gift of miracles. Please give me the gift of healing. I've been asking you for 3 years now and you still haven't given it to me. Why? What haven't I done right? What should I be doing more? Should I be a better Christian? Paul says, listen, relax. The Spirit is in charge of the gift-giving business. They're his gifts, and he gives gifts very carefully, very sensitively, very tenderly to the right people, not in terms of right people who have spirituality levels that are really high, but to the people that it is appropriate for them to work with. Oh, good, thank you. I thought it was my fault. No, just relax. But there are times when it is appropriate to pray for a spiritual gift. Well, you decide whether you think what I'm saying is true. I'm given a bit of a hint in chapter 14 when Paul says, now, make love your aim, earnestly desire the gifts of the Spirit, especially that you might prophesy. Now that sounds as if the best gift in the world is the gift of prophecy, because that seems to be what Paul is saying. Now I happen to know, and you will agree with me, that all the gifts of the Spirit are intrinsically equal, because they're given by the Spirit. So it's not that one gift is better than the other. Because they're all gifts from the Spirit, they're all perfect. They're all appropriate, they're all right. So Paul, why are you saying, especially prophesy? Well, let's think about it. What's going on in the church at Corinth? I'll tell you what's going on. This is a church that is dominated by a determination to get my will. And if that means that other people are put down, well, so be it. That's life. So if I am going to take you to court, and it means the church is demeaned in the public consciousness, well, tough, because it's my right to take you to court. All of the problems in the church at Corinth are because the Christians, unfortunately, have an inappropriate perception of themselves. And that lack of fellowship, that lack of togetherness has resulted in the church fragmenting and disintegrating. This is a church that has charismatic gifts, but it is in chaos because self determines what happens. And it looks as if people are speaking in tongues. I'm speaking in tongues. Pastor Jennifer says, well, I've got a word from the Spirit. And she starts to speak in tongues and I haven't finished. And then somebody else does the same. And there's chaos going on in the Church of Corinth. Your pastor wouldn't do that. She's not in Corinth. She's not a chaotic person. But that's what was going on in the church at Corinth. So Paul says, if you're going to speak, if you're going to use a gift, then make sure that it is a gift that is going to benefit the people, especially prophecy. And then he amplifies it in chapter 14 and says, let me give you a contrast. Here's my question. Which is the most significant gift? Given that I've already said all the gifts are equal, all the gifts are God-given, all the gifts have the Spirit backing, which is the most important gift? The gift of prophecy or the gift of tongues without interpretation? Both of them are given by the Spirit. Which is the most valuable? Well, the answer is obvious. It's the gift of prophecy. Because you understand when I give you a word of prophecy, because I'll give it to you in a language that you'll understand. But if I speak in tongues, you don't understand what I'm saying. And Paul says, in that regard, in that small area, that gift is less valuable than prophecy. So he says, if you're going to speak in tongues, make sure that somebody is there to interpret the tongue, so people can benefit the praise or the prayer that you're offering in that tongue. So he's not denigrating one gift over another. He is not offering a hierarchy of gifts. He's saying, make sure that the gift is functioning for the benefit of the people, much as we said earlier. So let's put that into practice. Here we are. We're in our church here at Lighthouse, and we're wondering, maybe God is leading us to establish a branch church somewhere. Where should it be? When should it start? Who is going to lead it? Are any of our folks going to be there? What are we going to do? Well, I look in the Bible for some guidance, and I don't find that Hong Kong is mentioned. So that's a problem straight away in terms of what we're going to do with this church plant. So where am I going to get my guidance? Well, as well as the Bible, the Spirit promises to be our guide. He is our teacher. So it would be appropriate in that setting, I suggest, that we would say to the Lord, Jesus, the Father, the Spirit, whichever you prefer, will you please give us some guidance as to when we should start this church plant, where we should do it, who should be seconded into that position, and the Spirit would reveal that information to us. In that regard, I think it's appropriate to ask for the Spirit to reveal himself in a spiritual gifting, maybe a gift of wisdom, or a gift of knowledge, or a gift of revelation, or a gift of prophecy. That's fine. We're not demanding it, but we are recognizing that's the only way we're going to go from A to B is if the Spirit gets involved. But we're still leaving it for him to give us the guidance when it's appropriate. Or imagine if somebody is in need of prayer for healing. The gift of healing is most appropriate to be asked for at that time. Please, Spirit, will you manifest your presence by the gift of healing? Or if we're not too sure what decision to make and we don't have a biblical promise to help us in our prayer, please will you give us a gift of faith, a burst of assurance that what we're about to say or what we're about to pray or what we're about to do is in keeping with your will. Because at the moment we don't know. Please give us a burst of assurance, a gift of faith. So in that regard, it's appropriate to ask. But Paul doesn't answer that question when he's referring to this verse. He's simply saying, trust the Spirit. He's in charge of the gift giving. Okay. Somebody else give me something else of an aspect of the Spirit here from these verses. Yeah.
There's more than one.
There is more than one. And let's check the text to see what the evidence is for that statement. Look at the way, yeah, varieties. Diaresis is the word that he uses there. Varieties of gifts, varieties of service, varieties of activities. He's made the point three times. And he's even used three different words to describe the gifts of the Spirit. He's not trying to be clever, but he is being deliberate. He's making the point that when the gifts of the Spirit are given to the church, the Spirit, by definition, is creative. I'm not even sure whether the gifts of the Spirit that are located in the New Testament are intended to be a comprehensive list of gifts. I think the Spirit is very capable, especially in this 21st century technological age, of using gifts for the benefit of his kingdom that wouldn't have been available in the first century. But Keith's fundamental point is there are varieties of gifts. There's more than one gift. In the verses here, there are nine of them. Do you know how many gifts of the Spirit are mentioned in the New Testament, as a matter of interest? Want to give a suggestion? Doesn't matter. Could have been a chance for you to be really proud if you'd got the answer right. It's too late. I'm not going to extend it any longer. That's probably because some of you were in danger of being proud. There are more than nine. Yep, that's a safe response. Very good. Anybody going to go higher than more than nine? There's also less than 6,000. So that's another safe response. There's over 20 gifts of the Spirit that are mentioned. In fact, Paul has got five lists of gifts. Some of the lists of gifts repeat one another within those listings. The gift of giving is mentioned. I often think about that because I don't score very high on giving. In fact, my wife Judy does score a bit higher on that, and I'll just let you into a secret. When we have a discussion as to maybe it would be nice to help somebody who needs some financial support, we come to the agreement that yes, we should give some money to this person, and then we say, how much should we give? Now, I have learned that Judy is always going to suggest more than me. And I have learned that by and large, it's going to be twice as much as me. So I know that for a start. So I have now learned to increase my limit so that it's not so bad in comparison with hers, because she manifests the gift of giving more than I do. Now, that is not an excuse to my niggardliness, but it is a fact that some of you have been gifted by the Spirit with the gift of giving more than others. Not just giving of money, in fact, quite often not giving of money, but you give time. You give yourself. And some of you do not think that that is a gift of the Spirit to you. You will tend to say, well, I've always been like that. I was like that when I was a little girl. When I was a little boy, I always was a bit generous. And you associate that as just being part of your DNA. Well, just remind yourself, who made you in the beginning? And the same Spirit who made you, the same God who incarnated you, the one who gave you your DNA, was also in charge of your giftings. I'll come back to this later. But that's just one gift of giving. It's only mentioned once by Paul in his lists. Others are mentioned more than once, but over 20 of them. But then he's got other gifts that are mentioned that he doesn't mention in any of the lists. So for example, Paul talks about the gift of singleness. The gift of singleness. Exactly so. Yeah, good. In other words, Paul is saying, some of you, I have chosen as a special gift, I want you to be single, because in that regard, you will be able to function in my kingdom with my blessing on your life because of that gifting that you have been given. Interesting, and so true. Here's another one that some of you aren't praying for. The gift of martyrdom. It's a gift that God gives to certain individual Christians. It's not me saying that, it's Paul saying that. He calls it a charisma. Charisma is the term that is used of spiritual gifts. It's not the only term that is used of spiritual gifts in the New Testament, it's one of them. The gift of martyrdom, Paul says, the Spirit has given to special people. It's their way of manifesting the Spirit's control in their lives. Whoa. So you're right, there is a variety of gifts, there's more than one of them. Tell me something else about them. I think you've already had to go, and you got your previous answer right, so I'm sorry, but you're not allowed, because the danger is you'll become proud, and you'll have to be you'll have to be disciplined and removed from the church. Look, see, even Pastor Renee is looking at who it was who said it. Now he's going to write your name down. I'll tell you her name. I'll come back to you later when we've run out of ideas. You got one?
Yes. The association of the same spirit to give,
yeah.
Lord to service,
yeah.
And God to activities and manifestation.
Oh, that's interesting. I haven't thought of that. What you're wondering is whether Paul is associating gifts with Spirit, service with Jesus, actions with God. That's interesting. I might need to think about that before I dismiss it too quickly as a silly response. But that's quite interesting. Yeah, thank you for that. Do you see the... You what? Yeah, 19. That's very interesting, because Paul is very deliberate in the way that he writes, as all the New Testament writers are. Never think that they just rush it down. These are thoughtful theologians who practically work their theology into light. So the question is whether Paul is saying, you've got gifts, they've come from the Spirit, who is a gift-giving being. Service, best emulated in the life of Jesus when he was on this earth. And activity, that's our God, who actively creates the universe and so forth. Good point, I like that. I must make a note of that when I finished. I thought you were actually going to point out the fact that the Spirit and the Lord and God are involved, which is what Pastor Jennifer said earlier. It's the same God who is involved in this process. I have talked about them as gifts of the Spirit, but too often that has restricted them as if that's what the Spirit does. The Father doesn't give gifts, and Jesus doesn't like giving gifts either. Thankfully, the Spirit is there, and he gives gifts. Oh, no, no, that's not the case. They're all involved in the process. We may call them gifts of the Spirit, but we already know that Jesus is involved in the Father is involved as well. This is a unity of the Godhead whose unified decision is, right, we're going to give gifts to the people, and we're going to give lots of different gifts to the people. And I want to add in Pastor Renee's comment that there is an association of the members of the Trinity with the way that the gifts function. They have already presented significant reasons why these gifts should function, and we are to emulate them in that regard. Good. Anything else? Anything else?
The Spirit should be manifested in our lives for the common
good. For the common good. So I'm hearing that. So you both are locked out. You're not allowed to speak anymore until May. So there's got to be some benefit to other people. Good.
Everyone. Each one.
Very good. a good scholar who provides evidence for her affirmation. To each is given? Each individually. Three times. Oh, and as you also mentioned, all in everyone. This looks as if this is a point that's particularly important because he mentions it four or five times. Every Christian has a gifting of the Spirit. Now, notice what he is not saying. He is not saying here every Christian has the potential of being gifted by the Spirit. That is true, of course. We all have the potential of being given any of the spiritual gifts that are mentioned in the list, gifts of the Spirit, that are mentioned in the lists. And he may create other gifts for us. We all have that potential. But that's not what he's saying here. Here, he's saying that every Christian is manifesting spiritual gifts, gifts of the Spirit. I need to spend a little bit of time on this one, I think. Because if you're like me, there are times in our lives when we will think we are not functioning in spiritual gifts, in gifts of the Spirit. And we will assume that that's what happens to other people. And it's not true. On the basis of this, the Spirit's role is already to implant within us gifts, strengths, talents, abilities, proficiencies, sensitivities. Our role as members of a local congregation is to help other Christians realize the gifts that God has already given to them. Do you hear what I'm saying? Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't pray for God to minister through us in a particular gifting. Of course we should, and there are plenty of opportunities for that to happen in reality. But it seems to me that too many of us don't realize what God is already doing through us because we don't look at ourselves accurately. We tend to look at ourselves as being less than adequate. We don't see our own strengths and our abilities. For example, if I had two whiteboards here and I asked you, if you were like me, to list all your good points, you'd struggle. And I would as well. Because even if I put, well, I think I'm a teacher, I would think, yeah, but you don't know everything, Keith. And some things you know now you didn't know before. And in fact, you've changed your mind on some things. You're not even reliable. And you're not as good a teacher as somebody else. And so if I write, you're a good teacher, I'll have crossed it off already. Well, what about, well, maybe I'm good humored, maybe I'm pleasant, but before I think about that too long, I will already think, yeah, but there are times when your humor goes too far and people misunderstand you and are unwittingly hurt by what you say. So I crossed that one out as well. So I'm struggling to find good points. On the other hand, if I had another board here, list my negative points, oh, I could keep writing for a long while. And you might not be any different to me, and you might think that that's being an authentic way of describing ourselves. The difference would be, is that if I asked Judy, who's my biggest fan, and I am of her also, please tell me some of my good points, she might actually have a more accurate perception of some of my good points. She might have a more accurate perception of some of my bad points as well. But my point is that we have a role to play in encouraging each other to realize the strengths that God already has given to us. There was a book that hit the New York Times bestseller list, and it was on the top of the list for some time. It was called The 1 Minute Manager. You may have read it, you may have seen it, it's still available today. The 1 Minute Manager. And it had as its theme this: catch people in the act of doing the right thing. Catch people in the act of doing the right thing and tell them. Encouragement. But as Christians, we're not very good at encouraging people. Well, I'm not good to encourage Pastor Rene because of his ability to do things here, because he already knows it. So why would I bother to tell him something he already knows? Or worse, we might say, well, I'm not going to tell him because he's going to become arrogant and proud. So I better protect him from that. I won't tell him. And before we know it, we don't give ourselves the opportunity to encourage Pastor Rene at all. On the contrary, we would never make him arrogant. We would instead give him the opportunity of realizing that we appreciated what he did, and that would give him a platform to even be better, if that's possible. Encouragement is so important for us. Because I suspect there are some of you here who are functioning in a particular way. And if we said, thank you because of this particular aspect to your life, your first response would be say, oh, no, no, it's okay. It's nothing. It's just me. I've always been like that. I don't even know this of your two pastors here, but I suspect that they would rather have one person with the gift of giving than 30 prophets or prophetesses, because the trouble with prophets and prophetesses is that they're not very good on hearing what leadership has to say to them, because they've got a direct message from God, and what they have got from God is what needs to be said. But the gift of giving, well, we'd have lots of them, because they do such a good piece of work to the community. Our role is to help people identify the gifts that God has given to them so that they have a position to function within them. I'm going to come back to that. Gracious me, time goes so fast here in Hong Kong. So it is very much slower in England. And I'm a lot more boring in England, actually, so that's really quite unusual. But I need to spend time exploring this because I think it's very practically important. But before I do that, is there anything else here that we're missing? In terms of, we've talked about the variety of gifts. We've talked about God who's involved in all of them. We've talked about it has to be for the benefit of the community. We've talked about the fact that to each believer there is a manifestation of the Spirit. Anything else that we're missing? Yep, so we got the same God is involved, good. I think we're pretty much... Now, there's not everything that is said here. Paul doesn't talk about the importance of checking the gifts and making sure that we assess their use. He doesn't talk about that, yet, but that's just as important. Somebody gives a word of prophecy, first thing we should do is just assess it. Is this coming from the Lord, or should we question whether this is a good point, but not necessarily from the Lord? Paul doesn't deal with that here. He deals with it elsewhere. And my role here is simply to see what he has to say in this passage. I think what I would like to do is just briefly now ask the question, how do we identify gifts that God has already given to us? That is not to exclude those gifts that he might give to us in the future, which might mean we function in that gift once and once only, or it might mean we function in that gift for a much longer period of time. Some suggestions that I've been thinking about. First of all, here's how I would try and help somebody identify the gift that God has given to them. It may be that I will see it in them before they will see it in themselves. It might be that you will see it in them before they will see it themselves. I've already indicated that we're not very good assessors of ourselves. We tend to do ourselves down. And sometimes it's our responsibility as fellow members of one another to say, you are such a gift to this church. Really? Why? Well, because, let me tell you, because this is what you do. This is how you function. And I believe that you are God's gift to this community. What do I do? Do I make them arrogant? Do I make them go and ask for a pay increase or even pay? On the contrary, what it does is lifts them up to a platform which says, well, thank you, Lord. I never realized that I was so important. Now I'm even going to function more effectively and conscientiously to warrant that affirmation that's been offered to me. So look for opportunities to affirm one another in areas where they are strong, where they're functioning in a way that is different to other people. Here's another suggestion. It seems to me that if God has given you a gift or a talent or a strength, you should be functioning successfully in it. In other words, if I say I have the gift of teaching, and already at least 2/3 of you have fallen asleep, and the other third is wondering, why aren't we so blessed that we can fall asleep? I'm probably not functioning with the gift of teaching. Or if I'm leaving you constantly confused, I need to probably sit down and somebody needs to tell me, Keith, I know it's my role to identify gifts that are in people. It's also my role to identify where there are not gifts in people and you are not functioning with the gift of teaching. So there needs to be confirmation. Once in a while, I'll have a student who come to me and I'll talk to them. What do you want to be in the future? I remember one who said, well, I want to win 250,000 people for Jesus. Great aspiration. A week later, we had some street evangelism. and said person was noticeable by their absence because somehow they found something else that they wished to do rather than engage in evangelism. You see, their aspiration was based on the accolade of having won 250,000 people for the Lord, but they weren't functioning as evangelists practically. It was just a dream. So there has to be some confirmation. I want to be a counselor. And yet I've got so many problems I can't even sort myself out. You might want to just question whether counseling is the gift that God has given to you. I'm not saying that a counselor has got everything sorted. That's not my point. But I'm saying there needs to be some confirmation in my activity. Let me give you an example of this. I was some years ago with a group of students, university students, with them for a weekend. And on the Friday evening, I didn't know the students, but they were all part of the same university Christian group. And I said, let's spend some time, split into small groups, and identify strengths that are within your colleagues in the group. And then after a while, we'll come and talk about it. So after about an hour of discussion within each group, I asked one of the groups, anybody want to say something? And one of the guys, whose name was David, said, well, I'll share. He said, what surprised me was that a number of my friends and colleagues who have known me for now 1, 2, or 3 years have wondered whether I might have the capacity to teach in a Christian context. I'm not saying that he was going to be a world-renowned teacher, but they just wondered whether he had the capacity to teach. And he said, I was quite struck by that. Because actually, it merges with my own increasing perception of myself. He was doing a degree in geography. But then the group said something quite interesting. They said, what we would like you to do, David, is to prepare 3 Bible studies for us in 2 months' time. Give you plenty of time to prepare for it. And we'd like you to do 3 Bible studies. On the one hand, he was scared to death. On the other hand, he was quite affirmed. And sure enough, 2 months later, he presented these 3 Bible studies. David finished his degree in geography. He then did a degree in theology. He then did a master's degree in theology. And he's now functioning as a priest in the Anglican Church in the UK with a gifting in teaching. Now, you hear my point. I wonder, in hindsight, how important that evening was as a catalyst when some of his colleagues, some of his friends, looked at him, sensed his strengths, sensed his personality, his character, had heard him previously functioning, and says, David, we just wonder whether this is maybe where God is leading you. And to test that, we're going to give you an opportunity to function in that regard. One of the young women on this side shared with us that she had been affirmed by her group as having the gift of administration. Not that they'd had some miraculous prophetic statement, but they just sensed, you're very organized, you're detailed, you're conscientious in a way that some of us aren't, and we wonder whether this is God's way of taking your gifts and using those gifts for the benefit of our community. It merged with her own thinking. In other words, she confirmed that this wasn't something a million miles away from her own perception of herself. And then they said, so what we would like to do in the new semester, we want you to organize us as a Christian community in the university. And she did it. And administration became a more significant part of her life. You hear my point? The group had a part to play in helping these two recognize some strengths that were within them that they themselves might not have recognized. They gave them the opportunity to prove the significance or the fact that those gifts were there, and then they moved it on. They give them opportunities to hone those gifts as you wish. So others will see it before you do sometimes. Look for confirmation that that is a gift, but what about this one? You should enjoy your gift. Now, I don't know whether this is you, but so if it isn't, then it isn't. But my upbringing was, if God gives you a gift, you're not going to like it. That's the nature of God. He doesn't give you good gifts. He gives you tough gifts. In fact, you shouldn't even enjoy being a Christian. You should enjoy being a Christian when you're dead. Once you're dead, and you have 3 days just getting over life on this earth, then you can enjoy being a Christian. But don't expect to enjoy being a Christian on this earth, because this is not, I can hear my leaders in my home church in Caerphilly saying, this is not a bed of roses, this is full of thorns. And there's truth to that, of course. Life isn't always easy for the Christian. But the impression that I was getting is, oh yeah, that's God. Don't expect him to give me something good. If he's going to ask me to do anything, it's going to be tough. Because God likes you to be out of your comfort zone. I'm not convinced that's true at all. Why would God want me out of my comfort zone when he has made me a particular type of person? And then he says, I know you're that, but actually I've got another plan. You're going to do that. I know you're not going to like it, but that's life. Get used to it. What kind of dictatorial, tyrannical God is that? That doesn't sound like my father. I used to pray a prayer because I knew the way God was. There was one country in the world that I had never been to and I never wanted to go to it. It's not Hong Kong. And so I used to pray a prayer, Lord, you know I'd go anywhere in the world for you, which was actually true, but I'd particularly like to go to this country, which was the country that I didn't want to go to. My leaders had told me about God. They'd given me the inside track. So I knew that God was thinking, Holy Spirit, note that one down. He wants to go there. Cross that one off. He's never going to go there. But the funny thing is, it worked. For years, I never went to that country. I have been to that country, of course. It didn't ever work, because God isn't that kind of God. But I was led to believe that you shouldn't enjoy the gift. Now, the fact is, I enjoy teaching. That doesn't mean to say that it doesn't have hard work. It does. It has research. Some of you would hate to teach. Not because you just don't like being at the front, but the notion of having to sit down for more than 5 minutes and studying would drive you doolally. So you're hoping that that isn't God's gift to you. And it's unlikely he would give it to you, because why would he? He's a God who treats us individually and personally and lovingly. But I think that if you enjoy doing whatever it is you're doing, it might be God's affirmation, this is what I want you to do. How do I know? Well, actually, because you're enjoying it, aren't you? Well, yes, I am. Well, then take it from me that this is my way of affirming that this is God's gift, my gift to you. Now, they're all little pointers. That's all. I'm not saying anything more than that. Couple more. What about this one? Oh, actually, I've got time for about a dozen more, but I'll be kind to you. What about this one? Explore the possibility that some spiritual gift that God wants you to use or to function in may be a gift that you had before you were a Christian. Well, I never functioned supernaturally before I was a Christian. Yeah, I know that. But there are some times when we assume that the gifts we have as Christians can only have been given to us after we become Christians, or after we've been baptized with the Spirit, or after we've had a special relationship with God. Well, sometimes those gifts do come after we've become Christians. It's difficult for you to have had the gift of miracles before you were a Christian, or the gift of healing before you became a Christian, or the gift of exorcism. Oh, as a matter of fact, you notice the gift of exorcism isn't mentioned as a gift of the Spirit. But it surely is a gift that the Spirit uses, but it's not mentioned in one of Paul's lists. So some gifts clearly come after salvation, but some may have been residential within your personality and your character before you were Christians. So don't dismiss them as being, well, that doesn't count. Let's take, for example, the Apostle Paul. Before the Apostle Paul became a Christian, he was a first-class evangelist. But not for the church, for the Jewish community. And then he becomes a Christian, and it's as if God says, excellent. I'm going to use that gift that I gave you, and you've been using it inappropriately. Now you're going to use it appropriately and share the gospel with the Gentiles. Or another aspect of Paul's personality before he was a Christian is that he was a great scholar. He was a teacher, trained under one of the greatest Jewish minds of the time, Gamaliel. When he becomes a Christian, God takes that gift and says, now I can use it for my purposes. And you're going to write significant doctrinal statements in the Bible. So my point is, don't assume that just because you have functioned in a particular way before you were a Christian, that that can't be something that the Spirit will want to use after. He is capable of redeeming that gifting and using it, but he may well use you in other regards as well. He is not restricted by his creativity. The only thing sometimes that restricts him is our inability that he desires to function within us. Perhaps the bottom line under all of this is that we let the Spirit determine our agenda. We have a part to play in helping one another, but we recognize the Spirit's agenda. I've just thought of one thing I want to say before I mention one last story. Let me be a bit thought-provoking here. I'm going to give you a list of questions or statements. Now, I'm not wanting this to be mathematical and scientific, and if you say yes to each one, oh, that's it, I've got the gift of healings. Now, that's not what I'm saying at all. But I'm trying to recognize that we can have a part to play in assessing whether God has given us a spiritual gift. But I don't want to be so mechanical that we think that we can manipulate it, because that's completely inappropriate. But what about some of you who already think, do you know what? I would love the opportunity to share in some format some of the study that I have done in the Bible. Some of you already sense that within yourself. But I don't know whether it's from God. Am I being precocious? Is this presumptuousness on my part? Am I being too cheeky? Do I need to be pulled down? Answer these questions. Are you the kind of person that enjoys experimenting with words? In other words, if I ask you to speak about the love of God, you're the kind of person that isn't going to run out of words after 30 seconds because you said God loves you. And another thing, he loves you. And the last thing I want to say, he really does love you. You're not that kind of person. You are going to play with that word love and explore the depth and the significance of what's involved in that word and use other words to make the point. You're not being clever. It's not just that you're being intellectual or showing that you have a penchant for words. It's demonstrating that you have the ability to dig deep into the meaning of a word and to paint it metaphorically in pictures to make the point more forcefully understood by the likes of me who's listening to you. Are you that kind of person? Are you the kind of person that enjoys research? Some of you already just felt, oh, a cold shiver went through your being then when I said that. Enjoy research? How can you enjoy research? You know the word oxymoron? It means when you put two words together that don't make any sense. Enjoy research. I enjoy research. What a strange, weird person I must be. Some of you would say, well, thank goodness there's somebody else, because I thought I was the only one. Are you that kind of person? Are you systematic? Are you logical in your thinking? Are you original? Are you a bit creative in your thought process? Sometimes you're so creative that you're afraid to share it because you think, well, people are going to be destabilized by my thinking. Is that you? Are you an interesting conversationalist? Do you enjoy reading? Can you concentrate? Are you a good storyteller? Do you enjoy discovering and sharing truth? You see, if you came to me and said, I am a bit like that, I would at least want us to say, okay, let's see if we can develop this to determine if this is a way whereby God might want to use you in the Christian community. Might not be the only way, might not be the most important way, but I don't want to lose sight of the possibility that this might be a way that God is already leading you in, and I want to tease out to determine if this is the case. And if so, maybe we'll look for opportunities whereby we can test it. We can suck it and see whether this is an appropriate gifting that God might be giving to you. Give me one more. What about this? Have I got the gift of service? Because that's one of Paul's charismatic gifts. Have I got the gift of service? Is this you? You can recall people's likes and dislikes. I struggle to remember people's names. In fact, I'm much preferring when Judy is with me, because sometimes I see somebody coming towards me, I know that they know who I am, and they know that they think I know who they are, but I don't. I've had people come into my office, and I've had to go outside the office and say to somebody, who's just come in? Which is worse if they're students, because I'm not very good at memories. You can recall people's likes, their dislikes. You can remember things they did a year ago. You remember the name of their grandchild. It's just you. What about this? Are you practical? You're talented in a practical way. My father was a carpenter. Judy will have many stories to tell you of the disasters that we have had in our house as a result of my non-carpentry skills. Not particularly practical. I have aspirations. I think I'm better than I am, but she's on hand to remind me I'm not. Some of you are. What about this? Are you motivated to meet needs quickly? I live by my calendar, my agenda. Well, I can't do that. I can do it next Thursday. Some of you don't function like that. If there's a need, you're there. You can't say no. It's just who you are. Even though you are very busy, you can't say no. And I suspect that if I spoke to your pastors and said, give me a list of those people who can't say no, they would know them straight away. In fact, they may be them themselves. That might be you. You might think, well, I'm not that important. You may have the gift of service, and the gift of service is one of the most important gifts that Christians can have to make sure that a group of Christians are together. Are you generous? Not necessarily with your money. You might not have much money, but the little you have, you're generous with that, but you're generous with your time, with your energy, with your ability to give of yourself to somebody else. Are you sensitive? Sensitive to the needs of others. Sensitive so that when somebody sees you and you see them, you sense that there's something behind the look on their face. That they have not reflected, but you just sense something. It might be a God-given sensitivity, but it might be a natural sensitivity that has been taken advantage of by God. Maybe you're sometimes quiet. You would hate being here. And if I was to want to bring you here so that I could thank you, you would run a mile. Because you don't like that. Some of us would be here straight away before you have the chance to say something that is worthy of us being thanked for. We come up just in the hope that you might find something to say that's going to make us feel happy. Not you. You work well with individuals and you are faithful. You are just so reliable. And you're always there. Some of you are that. And if some of you came to me and said, you know, that's a little bit like me, I would want to be saying to you, well, stop asking the Spirit for a gift. Just give him a break. And start recognizing that this is a gift that the Spirit has already given to you. Honor Him by functioning within it to the best of your ability and enjoy the fact that this is God's special gift to you and you are God's special gift to the community. You hear my point? Just in asking some general questions, this can be a helpful process. Last story. Two friends of one another. You may know their names. The one is called Peter Wagner. He was a professor of theology at Fuller Theological Seminary when he told this story. And the other is Bill Bright. Bill Bright was the founder of Campus Crusade for Christ, which was an evangelistic organization, powerful evangelist, creative in his different thinking about how to share the gospel with Jesus. Bill and Peter, very good friends with one another, and they would meet up from time to time. And I'll tell you the conversation that they had, because this is what Peter says in one of his books. He said, Bill, being the evangelist, would launch into the conversation, and he would immediately begin to talk about people who had come to faith in Jesus as a result of his witness. He wasn't showing off, but he was just so thrilled with the fact that people had come to know Jesus, and he'd been a participatory element in that process, that he wanted to share it. And they were great stories, because given that he had the gift of evangelism, it looked as if you only had to look in the direction of Bill and somebody would fall on their knees and ask Jesus to come into their lives. He was that powerful. And then after he had exhausted his range of stories, Bill would turn to Peter and say, so what have you been doing in recent months? And at that moment, Peter's heart sunk because he had nothing to contribute that compared with rescuing souls from the jaws of hell. Now, he had wonderful times with his students, and they'd explored texts from the New Testament, and they'd unpacked Greek, and they'd learned lessons about God that they'd never seen before. But however wonderful those stories were, they just didn't compare with having saved somebody from an eternity of hell. In time, Peter got not to look forward to meeting Bill, because he ended up leaving these occasions feeling depressed and discouraged. And then he said, the Lord said to me, stop worrying about whether I'm going to ask you how you've done with your gift of evangelism when you see me in heaven. Because I haven't given you a gift of evangelism. I've given you a gift of teaching. He said it was like a boulder falling off his shoulders when he began to relax and realize that what was most important was what was the gift that God had given to him. So he said, from that moment on, when I went on an airplane, I would say to the Lord, Lord, if the people want to talk about you, please open up a conversation. If not, please keep them quiet. So that I can get my books out and I can do my research. Because he wanted to develop his gift of teaching. Do you hear the point?
Yes.
For too long, he had been intimidated by other people's gifts. And I want to increasingly learn from people who have gifts of teaching, because I want to emulate them, especially if they can take me on further. And I want to honor people whose gifts are different to me. But in that regard, I don't want to be influenced in a way that makes me feel as if somehow I'm missing out on God's best for me. God's best for me is determined by God. And we have a part to help one another explore that. Well, I think I've talked enough. I think you've listened enough. The screen has come up to remind me that we have finished. It doesn't do that, actually, but I've decided that that is the sign. And it's gone off now, which is confirmation that our time has finished. So I think, good gracious me, is that 7 minutes to 6? Although it's not true. I know. But it's about time we had some of this potluck. I mean, I'm not overly comfortable with this pot. Is it potluck? It's America's. It's definitely not Christian. I'm surprised that you're even allowing it luck. I mean, it's terrible. I'm only teasing, obviously. I'm going to participate in it. In fact, we've brought some things. Tell you later. It's a secret, as Pastor Rene would say. So, shall I pray? Father, what a privilege to be members of your family and to be sisters and brothers, one of each other, and to be sons and daughters of our God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for honoring us by allowing us to be called joint heirs with yourself. And thank you, Spirit, for affirming these truths within us, because we are prone to disbelieve them. Thank you for your constant reminder of just how valued we are to you. And our response, as I've already said, Lord, is that we love you, we worship you, we give you ourselves, and our desire is to somehow live up to the expectations that you have of us, live up to the calling that you have given to us, not as a reward, but just to show our gratitude. And thank you for this day, all that we have done. Thank you for your presence. Thank you so much. Amen.